Greetings, dear viewer, and welcome to Purposes Crossed, where I hope that people who are called by Jesus for different purposes cross paths and exchange ideas. In this video, we continue with our series of reflections on the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount began with a series of Beatitudes in which Jesus described the traits of people who are transformed by that inbreaking kingdom of God that he was announcing. Then he moved on to a section in which he described his followers as salt of the earth or light of the world. And we devoted 5 videos to these 2 crucially important metaphors that speak about our role in this world. So thus far in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus has not really said anything that would warrant what he says in verse 17. This can only mean that the reason for him saying what he says in verse 17 lies further in the sermon. And we can see in verses 21 to 48, Jesus challenges the prevalent interpretations of Torah, which could only have led to conclusions that he was dismantling it, to ward off such conclusions with the hope that his hearers would not prejudice their understanding of his purpose. Jesus prefaces the bulk of his teachings with this disclaimer. It is important that we realize this and take seriously what Jesus says about how Torah and his words relate to each other. Now, we might think that the disclaimer is unnecessary or even that Torah, that is the law, is obsolete. After all, are we not under grace rather than under law? However, it is precisely because we tend to think like this that Jesus' words are still relevant. In the second century, a Christian named Marcion declared that the Old Testament was irrelevant and indeed unfit for Christians. Thankfully, his view was rejected by the church. However, his kind of thinking lingers with us. We are both quick to affirm the Old Testament as scripture and then at the next breath to declare that it is irrelevant. We reject Marcion's position in theory while affirming it in practice. And because of this, we need to pay close attention to Jesus' words in this verse. Jesus clearly declares that the Old Testament stands as scripture to be heeded even in light of his work. His coming does not herald the end of the validity of the Old Testament. If anything, Jesus' coming affirms its validity. What Jesus does is to warn us against seeing too much discontinuity between Torah and his teachings and between the ministry of the prophets and his ministry. Rather, he tells us that the significance of his teachings can only be understood when his teachings are taken to be fundamentally continuous with the Old Testament. When the church has forgotten or denied that Jesus' work is a continuation of the revelation in the Hebrew scriptures, we have engaged in many atrocities, leading to anti-Semitism of all sorts, with the Jewish people facing most persecution in supposedly Christian nations. We need to remember that Jesus is not a Christian. He was, is, and always will be a Jew. And his work is the final revelation in the sequence of revelation we find in our Hebrew scriptures. This does not mean that Jesus does not challenge accepted understandings of the Old Testament. After all, if his ministry is much like the ministry of the prophets, challenging the status quo is exactly what we would expect him to do. In other words, his ministry should be seen as a critique from within Judaism rather than a rejection of Judaism. This is crucial, and both Christians and Jews need to remember this. The most Jewish thing that Jesus did was call the Jewish people to repentance. When he announced judgment on the Jewish leadership and on the Jewish nation, this is just a continuation of what the prophets had done centuries earlier. It is precisely because he did not abolish Torah that Jesus called the Jewish people to account in this great sermon. It is precisely because he saw the enduring relevance for the Jewish people that he declared that he had not come to abrogate the Torah. But we also need to understand who he was speaking to. His audience consisted of Jewish people, and to them he insisted that his words should not be construed as abolishing Torah. But this does not mean that he would have said the same thing to Gentiles. If we insist that Torah observance is necessary for Gentile believers, we fail to understand why God gave Torah to Jewish people. In other words, Jesus' claim that he was not going to abolish Torah does not mean that he intended non-Jewish people also to obey Torah. But just because Jesus did not intend non-Jewish people to obey Torah does not mean that we should not study Torah and understand it and its role in the purposes of God for His good creation. Torah was and is a good thing, and it had a crucial role to play in God's plan of salvation. But as we move forward in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus will show us how we are to understand and interpret Torah according to the spirit that undergirds it, rather than just the words used to express it. And that is where we will find its continuing relevance.